Mead was also struck by the Samoan attitude towards sex.
Sometimes sleep did not descend upon the village until long past midnight. Then at last there is only the mellow thunder of the reef and the whisper of lovers as the village rests until dawn.
Adolescence was not a time of stress and angst and fighting and rebelliousness, but rather a time when adolescents could experiment with intimacy, with sexuality, and Mead found this very liberating.
Indeed, so different was growing up in Samoa compared to the States that Mead was moved to call Samoan adolescence a period of perfect adjustment.
These things that made it hard for adolescents here weren't there. So I was able to come back and say that adolescence is not necessarily the kind of time that we've made it in Europe and America, that the kind of stress that we put on young people induces the kind of Sturm und Drang, the storm and stress that exists, but it isn't necessary.
Here then was the proof that Franz Boas had been searching for, that Samoan teenagers experienced none of the growing pains that American teens did. And if Samoan teenagers didn't have stress, then that meant that stress was not innate. It must be determined by one's upbringing, not one's genes. And if that was true, then not just American adolescents, but human beings the world over must be the products not of nature, but nurture. After a stay of 9 months, Mead wrote to her tutor, Franz Boas, informing him that her work was done.
Now that this year's fieldwork is finishing up, it's possible to look back and evaluate it. It's been such fun being able to talk the language and make speeches, being the center of genuine ceremonies rather than merely a strictly scientific onlooker. I shall not be entirely at ease until I have laid my work in your hands, but I am finishing up my stay in the field with a good taste in my mouth.
Little did Mead know just what sort of impact her work would have. In 1928, Margaret Mead published her findings in a book titled Coming of Age in Samoa, going on to sell several million copies in 9 languages. It would become one of the best-selling social science books of all time.
The book was a phenomenal success. It was readable, it was literate, it was sympathetic, and it ended, best of all, with some prescriptions for how to transform our own family lives and society.
Mead's message was simple. Humans weren't just determined by their biology. Instead, we all had it in our power to change our lives.
I think that Americans found this message that it wasn't in our genes, but it was in our cultures, to be a very acceptable message. It was a very American message.
What she offered was the sense that we can make choices about the kind of society we want to be. We have that freedom.
Propelled by the phenomenal success of Coming of Age, Margaret Mead went on to become one of the most preeminent anthropologists in the world.
Coming of Age in Samoa made Mead a celebrity way beyond academia. She became a spokesperson for the power of culture and socialization, for showing us just how variable humanity can be.
Though she later acknowledged the role of biology in human development, Mead remained a symbol of the overriding importance of nurture. So powerful was Mead's philosophy that 40 years later, it would be embraced by an entirely new generation. A generation inspired by its utopian message that we could change our lives for the better. God only knows what
I'd be without you. Mead's arguments, not only in Coming of Age, but in her subsequent books from the South Seas, certainly contributed to the countercultural revolution of the 60s.
She touched the heart of a young nation that was in rebellion, particularly when it came to women's sex lives. God only knows what
I'd be without you. When the 60s came, when these liberation movements began to form, she immediately allied herself with the kids. And she would sit on the Columbia campus talking to the kids who were demonstrating, and they would say, "But Dr. Mead, you understand us."
In later years, Mead took to carrying a staff and wearing capes, gradually resembling a prophet more than an anthropologist.
We face the task of recognizing that all men are indeed our neighbors and our brothers.
She was an oracle. Mead had an opinion, and in fact, the common question, the cliche was, what would Margaret Mead say?
Yes, that's right.
But if Mead's persona brought her worldwide fame, it also made her enemies.
Waters doesn't come down, and I didn't take it.
Only a few years after being voted one of the three most famous women in American history, Mead and her message that nurture outshone nature became the focus of one of the most bitter feuds in the history of science. The man behind the row was Derek Freeman.
He was seen as a person that was unstable emotionally, that was given to great mood swings.
Freeman was professor of anthropology at the Australian National University.
I'm told he could be very charming, though I think he was probably a bully all his life.
A man with a reputation for being difficult.
This was a guy who saw the world as full of either supporters or enemies. And if you were his supporter, you were his for life. And if you were an enemy, he would go to great steps to try to treat you that way and to make sure you knew it.
Early on in his career, Freeman had been a believer in Margaret Mead and the supremacy of nurture over nature.
When I was a student, I worked in the seminar of Ernst Spiegelhauer, and he introduced me to anthropology and to Margaret Mead's work, and in particular taught us that this book, which was then already well known, was of great anthropological significance.
Such was his fascination with Mead's book that in 1940, Freeman visited Samoa himself. Over the course of the next 3.5 years, Freeman got so close to the Samoan people that he'd be granted an honor that had eluded even Mead.
Quite unexpectedly, all of the chiefs of the village assembled and said that they were going to give me a title, an important title of the village. This title is Longona Itanga, which literally means heard at the tree felling, and it is the title of the heir apparent of the high chief of the village.
His self-image was affected by that title, and he took great pride in the fact that the Samoans valued him highly.
This acceptance by the Samoans was absolutely overwhelming. He used to cry. He would cry whenever he talked about it.
As a chief, Freeman was granted unrivaled access to the inner workings of Samoan society.
And it was then that I began to realize that many of the things that Margaret Mead had reported in Coming of Age in Samoa certainly did not accord with what I was witnessing.
He began to see that the Samoans were not the bland, innocuous, affectless, tranquil people that Mead had seen them to be, or portrayed them to be. The Samoans were full of jealousy, hatred, aggression, possessiveness, and all the things that in fact make them human, but that Margaret Mead had...